rise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms, in the arms of Christ my Savior.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome those watching this TV program this morning to stay with us and be blessed by the preaching of God's Word. In 1 Corinthians, the Bible says that God chose the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. If you'll take your Bibles and open up to 2 Peter chapter 3 with me, please. There's two things that stand out in this world today. There's two things that cry out. One is heaven and one is hell. Both places will be inhabited one day. Both places will have multitudes of people, that which God created. You see, there's a fight going on. There is a war going on. And God is trying to win us over to His side so we can spend eternity with Him. And the devil's trying to win us over to his side so that we can spend eternity with Him. The Bible, the Word of God. God has caused this Bible to be written so that you and I could have the information that we need to do one of two things. We can read the Bible and we can make an educated decision that I want to go to heaven to be with the Lord Jesus Christ for all eternity. Or we can read the Bible also and make an educated decision that I want to go to hell and live for eternity. Yes, I put it that way because that's the way it is. You see, I decide, not God. God has prepared the way. He has laid the rules down. I decide whether I follow them or not. I decide whether I go to be with Jesus or not. God doesn't do that. Jesus don't do that. He doesn't decide for me. And also, I decide whether I want to go to hell or not and live in the lake of fire. That is my decision. That's not Jesus' decision. Jesus has prepared the way. He laid down the rules. And He gave me this book and gave me all the information I need to make an educated decision. Too many times, one chooses to go to heaven without the information that they need. But at the same time, one chooses to go to hell without the information that they need. Why do I say it that way? Well, the only thing that you and I know about heaven and hell is that which is written in the Word of God. No one, except for Jesus Himself and for those who have already gone there, know anything about heaven. You and I that still live on this earth, we do not know anything about heaven other than that which is written. And so therefore, if I want to make an educated decision to go to heaven, I have to go to the Bible to be able to do that. There's none of us know what hell's like either. I know there's people say, use the term, it's hotter than hell on this earth. And they don't have a clue what they're talking about. People at the same time say it's colder than hell. Don't have a clue what they're talking about. We don't know what hell's like. No one does except those who have already gone there. Okay? That from heaven and from hell, no one is coming back. Okay? No one's coming back to tell us what it's like. The only way we know what hell is like is that which is written in the book. And if I want to go to hell, I can go with an educated decision, knowing I'm making the right decision to do that. You see, the Bible tells me the goodness of heaven. Know all the glories and how pleasant it is when in Revelation chapter 19 the Bible says that there be no sickness, no death, no pain, no crying there. It'll be a perfect place. There is no more darkness there. But the Bible also says that hell is a lake of fire and brimstone. It stinketh there where the worm never dieth. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. And no one will ever escape it. You see, the Bible tells me what those two places are like. The Bible helps me, gives me the information I need to decide where do I really want to go. Do you know? Now listen up, folks. By studying the Bible, not studying the Bible, listen up. This could determine whether you go to heaven or hell. By not studying the Bible, you can never make it to heaven. You can never make it to heaven. Without studying the Bible, you will always, you will every time, you will be guaranteed to go to hell. By not studying the Bible, you can never make it to heaven. By not studying the Bible, you will for certainly go to hell. No wonder when God made provision to have this here book written, that it cost lives. It was important. Jesus died for this book. He laid His life down so that you and I could have it. The apostles died. They laid their lives down so that we could have this book. I'm telling you, the apostles wrote these letters, the New Testament letters. And they gave their lives to see that it was written. When they wrote these letters, they put it in the hand of evangelists and teachers. And they were to guard it with their life and take it back to the churches, the cities, and preach and teach it. That's why this book is so important to you and me. It's God's information to mankind. One of two things is going to happen, my friend. We live in a world where we have doom and gloom all around us. We live in a world that every teaching and doctrine is taking place. We live in a world where hatred is abounding and the love of God is not. We live in a world where people don't care anymore. We live in a world where people want to speak what their mind says and not what God says. And because of that, we live in an ungodly world. You see, the Bible is our help. Yeah, take a look at your life. I need to take a look at my life. And where is it with the Lord God? Well, a few things will help us, give us a hint. Either I've got my eyes fixed on heaven, as Robert said in his thing for the Lord's Supper, looking things that are above and not things that are below. And I'm counting on the Lord Jesus Christ to do in my life that which He promised. And I'm putting my trust in Jesus and His Word that He's going to lead me from this life into the next. And I want you to know this morning that I can testify that the Almighty God has brought me thus far. He has never let me down. He was always has taken care of my needs. He's always seen that I have a job. He has always seen that I could take care of my family. He's always seen that I had good health. I'm reaching almost 60 years old. And it's because of the Almighty God that I can stand before you this morning and preach. That's what God has promised. God promises eternal life to every person. Every person. You, my friend, And every person in the world, God promises eternal life with Him someday. If you'll follow Him and His Word, if you'll be faithful and obedient to His Word, Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And He has a kingdom, and it's the church. The church is not this building. It's those who have been obedient to the gospel of Jesus Christ and have repented of their sins and have been baptized by immersion to have their sins washed away and to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit and live faithfully unto death. That's the kingdom that Jesus reigns over from heaven. There's a cry going out. Heaven's crying out from the presence of Almighty God. We are His creation. And He wants us back. He wants us to be faithful to Him. He wants us to be faithful unto the end so that we can hear those words from the mouth of Jesus. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joys of thy Lord. Jesus wants to see you, my friend, entering into the pearly gates of heaven. Jesus gave His life on Calvary. Jesus was resurrected from the dead by the power of God. Jesus is at the right hand of the throne of God in heaven, making intercession for you and for me. Jesus is calling the world to repentance and to come home to Him. In 2 Peter chapter 3, let's read, starting with verse 1. This second epistle or letter, beloved, I now write unto you, in both which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance. Peter's saying, he is teaching us things that we already know. When's the last time you said, I've heard that message before? I've heard that teaching before. I don't need to hear it again. I've already heard that. No, Peter says we need to be reminded of the things that we already know. There is no new thing under the sun. We have the complete written Word of God. We have the will of God right here in this book. Everything that God wants us to know of how to get to heaven is here in this book. And Peter says, I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance. Remember! Remember! That ye may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior. Jesus did not save the world alone by Himself, my friends. Now that's going to cause controversy. But Jesus made that way Himself. He decided to be that way Himself. And He said that His apostles also would have the keys to the kingdom. In Matthew chapter 18 and verse 19, 16 verse 19, the apostles carried on what Jesus started. And they wrote the New Testament books that we have. Jesus and His apostles opened up the door to the church, the kingdom. Jesus and His apostles made it possible that you and I have the written Word of God and we can come to Jesus now. Knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers walking after their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of His coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. For this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was, being overflowed with water, perished. The Bible's prophesying something here that had already taken place one time. God destroyed the world by a flood in Noah's time. He's going to destroy it again. This world's going to be destroyed. We need to be telling people, this world's going to be destroyed by God. We need to be telling our kids and our grandkids, this world's going to be destroyed by fire and brimstone. It's going to perish. And so therefore, we should not be digging our roots too deep in this life. We should not be putting our trust in man and physical things. We should not be wanting this life more than heaven. So much that we don't choose to follow what the Bible says. There'll be scoffers coming in the last days, walking after their own lusts. And the last days were the time when Jesus died and resurrected and went back to heaven. Not right now. It has been taking place since then for the church. And these men don't care what they say and do, what kind of teaching and doctrine they hit. They are like Satan, because he's the father of liars, the Bible says. And they are out to deceive. We can get on any subject in this lifetime, and there are pros and cons to it. One person will say this about this person, another person come along and say a different thing about this person. You and I have been given by God the written Word of God, so that you and I can tell the difference, distinguish the right and the wrong. We have so much information going out in our world today that it fills our minds. Our minds, I don't know about yours, but my mind is full of information. And a lot of it's good and a lot of it's bad. And it brings confusion. If I didn't have God's Word, if I couldn't go to God and pray, if I didn't have the Holy Spirit, I would be confused, my friend. I'd be confused. And that's the job of the devil. That's exactly what he wants to do. And I'm telling you, we have God's Word. He warns us. He warns us about the devil. I haven't seen the devil in any time. But I believe that what the Bible says about him, he's like a roaring lion, going to and fro, seeking whom he may devour. That's what the devil is. He wants to destroy you, the devil does. The devil wants to make your life miserable. He wants you to hate God. He wants you to hate Jesus. He wants you to hate the angels that are still with God. He wants you to hate your mom and dad, your aunt and uncles, your brothers and sisters, grandpa and grandpa. He wants you to hate the world. That's what the devil wants. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. The devil so hates the world that he wants you to hate God, hate Jesus, hate the Bible, hate the Holy Spirit, hate the Christians, hate the saints, the church, anything about God. Because he knows he has but a short time. When Jesus comes back, he knows he's going to his own place, to the lake of fire. Yes, the devil and his angels are going to the lake of fire, in that lake of fire and brimstone for all eternity. And he's trying to take... Now listen up, folks. Listen up. This ain't no TV show on TV. This is real. The devil is here to try to get you away from God. Steal you away from God. Cause you to have doubts in the Almighty God, in Jesus Christ. He wants you to disbelieve it. He wants you to get to the point where you don't take action, where you don't talk about the Lord anymore, where you don't pray anymore, you don't think about Him anymore. The Bible says in Romans chapter 1, they don't even like to retain God in their minds, in their knowledge. How could that possibly be? Satan didn't create us. Satan didn't give us what we have. Satan doesn't bless us. Satan didn't die for us. Jesus did. And when a person gets to the point where they do not like to retain God in their knowledge anymore, they've been around Satan too long. And it's time to repent of that and get back to Jesus Christ, the one who died for you. He went on to say, verse 7. But the heavens and the earth, which are now, by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. We've been talking about the ungodly men. That's what we've been talking about. There's ungodly men. They hate God. And our kids and our grandkids spend a whole lot of time around that. You see, they don't talk about Jesus. Kids talk more about Satan than they do Jesus Christ. Why is that? Because we allow it. We're the cause. We're the problem of it, parents, grandpas, and grandmas. We don't tell them about Jesus. We don't give a little time so they can read the Bible. But we make sure that we push them out into the world. Let Satan have them. Let the influences of Satan have them. What do you think is going to happen to you and me, my friend, when we stand before the Almighty God? From the Old Testament to the New, God is always required that we keep His laws, His commandments, and His statutes. Teach them to your children and your children's children. That's what God says. He doesn't turn away from that. He has never changed. It is still the same with Him. We're the one that has changed and moved away. You see, we live in a society where it paints the picture not of God, not of what He wants, but what the devil wants. It paints that kind of a picture. And we have bought into it. We have bought into it. Oh, I long for the day. I long for the day. When we talk, every one of us, all I hear come out of our mouth is what's written in the Word of God. I tell you what, that'd be so grand. That would be such greatness. It would be superb. It'd be wonderful to hear God's people when they talk. It's about God. It's about Jesus Christ. It's the Scripture that they've been reading and studying. That's what God wants. That's what He wants. He wants His children to say what He says. He's our Father in heaven. We're to be like Him. Yeah, we're to be like Him. We're to talk like Him. You know when people call James and I on the phone, they have to ask, who is this? Or they might say, hey, Jay. Or they might say, hey, James. Because we sound alike on the phone. Our voice sounds alike on the phone. Do you know what? That's what God says. He's our Father in heaven. And when we talk, we ought to sound like Him. When we talk, people ought to recognize, hey, their Father is in heaven. Their Father is in heaven. Yeah, that's what we ought to sound like. That's what He's talking about. There's a day reserved for this world and for ungodly people. A day reserved unto fire and judgment. God, not man. God will destroy this world by fire and brimstone. God will destroy this world like nothing else could ever. Let's read on. But beloved, in verse 8, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. And it's talking about a large number. It's figuratively speaking. The Lord is not slack concerning His promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God wants the whole world to come to repentance. God isn't willing that any man or woman perish and go to hell. God wasn't willing for Adolf Hitler to go to hell. God wasn't willing for any of these other dictators to go to hell. God isn't willing for Obama to go to hell. God isn't willing for you or for me to go to hell. But He has called us to repentance. He's calling all men everywhere to repent, every person to repent. Turn away, that's what that word repentance means. Change of mind of the way that you're living and you turn towards God. That's what repentance is. That's something you do and I do, not God. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, and the earth also, and the works that are therein, shall be burned up. This earth is going to burn up. It's going to perish. It's going to melt with fervent heat. And it's going to dissolve. Candles melt, right? Stick them on the fire and they start melting and dripping. What does steel do? Doesn't it melt? It does. When you get stuff as hot as steel is, what does it do? It dissolves, disintegrates. Disintegrates. Just disappears. That's the way this world's going to do. When God destroys by fire, it's going to melt with fervent heat, the Bible says. It's going to burn up. Everything in it is going to burn up. And it's going to dissolve. But the heavens is also going to dissolve too, the Bible says. Yes, the sun, the moon, the stars, and the very dark space is going to dissolve. And the only thing left to be going to be standing is what God says. Okay, what God says. The only thing left to be standing will be His Word. That eternal kingdom where Jesus is right now. That's what's going to happen to this world. We have the Bible, it gives us that information. Do you believe it? Do you believe it? If there was a tornado coming right now, you could see it out that window. Would you believe it is a tornado? And it was coming directly toward us. It's just outside that window. Would you just sit there and say, "Praise God, come and get us"? No. We would get up because we've been taught that that's dangerous and it could kill us. And we'd go and find the safest place that we possibly could. My friends, the Bible is warning us. It's giving us information that God, listen, that God is going to destroy this world by fire and brimstone. If God could show us what hell looks like, listen, my friends, if God could open up hell and let us see down hell, and the people have already gone there and they're down there crying and gnashing their teeth and they can't get out, and someone would be our loved ones, how serious would you take it then? Well, we need to take that serious now. Because you know what? We do have loved ones that are not right with the Lord. And if you die or Jesus comes back and you're not right with the Lord, you will not go to heaven, but you'll spend eternity in the lake of fire and brimstone. I'm telling you, God is a loving God. He loves us so much, He wants us to warn us. He wants to warn us so that we don't have to go to that dreadful place. The rich man, Lazarus, in Luke chapter 16, starting with verse 19. He lifted his eyes up in hell, the rich man did, in this flaming torment, and he cried unto Abraham, "Father Abraham, send Lazarus down, they may dip his finger in water and cool off the tip of my tongue." And he also said, "Send someone to my brother's house." He had five brothers that were still alive. Listen, folks. This man was a rich man. He was supposed to be wise. And he lifted his eyes up in hell. And he said, "It's so bad, please send someone to my brother's house so that they don't have to come to this dreadful place." He did not want to see his brothers anymore. In order for him to see his brothers, they would have to come down there where he was in that dreadful place. And he didn't want them to come there. Folks, God loves us. He gave us the information to tell us about this place. He loved us. He gave us the information to tell us about this place. Will you use that information so that you don't have to go there? Will you tell your kids and your grandkids about this place so that they won't have to go there? You know why people don't read the Bible? Because when God warns you, it scares you. Hell isn't something that we like to think about. Death isn't something that we like to think about. And so we don't go there. We want to do everything else that makes us feel good. And it's easy. Don't cause us no pain. Don't cause us no ache and agony. Makes us happy. Makes us feel good. But God has never, my friend, God has never, ever in His Word said that's the way it's going to be. God is calling us to repentance. He's calling this world to repentance. He's calling the church to repentance. My friend, Jesus could come back today. You know, every time someone says that, you know, first thing comes to my mind. But He could also not come back for 1,000 years. What am I saying when I do that? I've got time. I've got time. I know of 2 people right off the top of my head that died yesterday or last week. I know there are countless of people dying today, even as we speak. And if they haven't done what they're supposed to do to make themselves right with God, they're lost. And they're going to the lake of fire to spend all eternity. And it's too late for them. There's not a thing they can do, not a thing that you and I can do, and not a thing that God wants to do. Because God gives us the time right now. Right now is the time. See? The Bible says in Hebrews, 2 Corinthians, behold, now is the day, the acceptable time of salvation. Right now. You know, I could die today. I could die today. I heard about a young boy, his grandpa died a day, 2 or 3 ago. Yeah, his grandpa died. I could die today. Something can happen to me today, and I'll die. And if I'm not right with God, I'll go to hell. I'll go to hell. What person in their right mind would want to go to hell? Mike Breitenbaugh says, it wouldn't take a person 1/2 of a second to decide that I would want a wheelbarrow full of gold. If someone offered you a wheelbarrow full of gold, free, it's yours, no ties to it, it wouldn't take you but 1/2 a second to say yes. But when someone offers you eternal life with Jesus, sometimes it takes 5, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years, 60, 70, 80, 90 years to decide whether I want eternal life or not. And I'm telling you, God has provided the way. He has provided the sacrifice. He has provided the atonement for our sins. And it was in Jesus Christ when He died on the cross and shed His blood and His death. And God, through Jesus and the apostles and His Word, He has opened up the doors to the kingdom of heaven, which is the church. And He has given us time right now as I speak for every person in this world to make a decision. And if your decision comes to an end, if you die today and you haven't made the right decision, you'll be lost, my friend. You'll be lost. That's what God's all about. Okay? What did you think about all last week? What'd you do all last week? Where'd you spend your time all last week? What did you talk about all last week? You know what? God's going to tell us what we did with that time, what we said, when we stand before Him. God has given us time right now to get it right with Him. Do you need to make a decision for the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you want to escape hell and make heaven your home? Do you want to be forgiven of your sins by God Himself? Well, the Bible says you need to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. By believing that message, one repents of their sins. Repentance is a change of mind toward the way that you're living, and you turn towards God. The Bible says one must be baptized by immersion to have your sins washed away and to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, not to help you speak in tongues and do miracles, but to help you live a faithful life unto Jesus and His Word unto the end. If you are a Christian this morning, and you're not walking with the Lord as it was when you first became a Christian, and you know you need to make a decision and turn back to the Lord, the Bible says you need to repent, my friend. Don't need to be baptized again. You need to repent if you're a Christian. God made provision for that in 1 John 1:9. The Bible says that if we will confess our sins to Him, Jesus, He is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God will restore you back again with Him.